This is the story of DART 21. DART 21 was a civilian airplane operated and maintained by Phoenix Air with a very special mission. It was a Lear 35 that had been modified to support the Air National Guard in its training missions. On the 14th of December 1994, that's exactly what November 521 Papa Alpha was up to. It had been supporting two Air National Guard F-16s in restricted airspace near the Sierra Nevada mountain range, and it was headed back to Fresno. At 11:41 a.m., DART 21 was descending through 11,500 feet. They were in contact with Fresno approach control. Nothing out of the ordinary so far. At 11:43 a.m., DART 21 was asked to turn to 290 degrees and to descend to 4,000 feet. The controllers were setting the plane up for an approach to runway 29 right. The Learjet complied. As the jet descended through 9,000 feet, when it was 10 nautical miles northeast of Fresno Air Terminal, a radio call came in from the Learjet. Declare an emergency, engine fire, immediate vectors. The controller asked them about the runway that they'd be using, and the crew decided to go with runway 29 right. The controller told them that the airport was 4 miles away at their 12 o'clock. The pilots could see the airport. They said, field in sight. As DART 21 switched over to the tower frequency, the radio malfunctioned. No, the radio didn't cut out. The opposite, in fact. Everything that was happening in the cockpit was now being broadcasted on the tower frequency. There was heavy static on the channel, sometimes so strong that it was hard to hear the pilots over it. In the cockpit, they were trying to keep the burning plane under control. Their right-hand engine was on fire, or so they thought. The pilot wanted to do a 270-degree turn to bleed off some airspeed. In the control tower, they saw the plane turn to the south as if it was beginning the 270-degree turn, but soon it turned back. Within minutes, it had passed through the extended centerline of runway 29 right without lining up. Air National Guard pilots on the ground, who rushed out, saw the plane in a right bank. They said that the plane was making no attempt to line up with the runway. Quote, "The nose was not tracking at all," end quote. Meanwhile, in the cockpit, the pilots were trying their best to get a handle on their plane. The controllers could see that the plane had overshot the runway and now it had begun to lose altitude. They could see that the plane was trying to gain altitude, but it kept descending. Then it went below the trees and they saw a column of smoke in the distance. DART 21 had gone down on East Olive Avenue in Fresno. The plane had crashed near the intersection of East Olive and North Chestnut Avenue, and there were quite a few buildings there. The resulting fireball set multiple buildings on fire. Some of them were apartment units. Both pilots on board did not make it, and 21 people on the ground were severely injured, but no one on the ground was killed. Since the radio had malfunctioned, the controllers could hear everything that was happening in the cockpit in real time. They could hear that the pilots were having really bad trouble controlling the plane. Eyewitnesses on the ground backed that up. They saw gray smoke trailing from the right-hand engine. Now the question becomes, why was the plane on fire? The right wing and the right engine was found about 1,200 feet from the initial impact points. They then disassembled the right-hand engine to see what it was doing at the time of impact. They saw that the right-hand engine showed no signs of internal or external pre-impact fire damage. That meant that the right-hand engine was not on fire. Something else brought this plane down. More analysis showed that the plane was indeed on fire, but it was not the engine as previously thought. There were strong signs of a fire in the electronics bay at the back of the plane. The wires of the fire warning circuits were near the fire, and the fire destroyed them, triggering the engine fire warnings, which is why the pilots thought that they had an engine fire. A fire here from the ground would look like an engine fire. So that explains what the pilot saw and what people on the ground saw. Under the skin of the fuselage, at the back of the plane, the fire damage was apparent. The interior was caked with soot. Wires had been melted and fused together. Basically, the plane was melting as the fire raged in the back. But what caused the fire? Looking back at the history of the plane that crashed, they found something interesting. The plane was a public-use plane. That is, it's just a standard Learjet that you or I could buy, if we had millions and millions of dollars just sitting around, that is. But to participate in these training exercises with the Air National Guard, the plane had to be modified quite extensively. On October 22, 1992, the plane was modified and special electronic countermeasure pods were installed. The countermeasure pods would suck up 300 amps of power at full draw. According to the documentation, the ECM pods would use power from the generator control panel. But the investigators found something completely different. They found out that the ECM pods were getting their power directly from the battery charging bus. Basically, imagine if someone told you to plug a very important appliance into a specific power socket, and you go and plug it into another power socket that you just saw that was not designed to power this appliance. That's basically what happened. In essence, the implementation was not according to spec. Now, that seems like a small problem. You took power from the battery bus instead of the generator control panel. Big whoop. As long as the equipment works, isn't that all that matters? Right? Wrong. The generator control panel offers overload protections to whatever is being connected, meaning that it would prevent too much power from flowing to the connected device. But instead, what they had done was that they took power from the battery bus and then passed the power through a 150 amp limiter. So essentially, that section of wire between the battery bus and the 150 amp limiter was not protected from overloading if there were to be a short circuit in that section of wire. What this meant was that an 18-inch strip of wire would be subject to currents larger than what it could handle. When the investigators took a look at those wires, they found signs of arcing, and in places the wires were welded to the current limiters and the battery buses. A huge amount of power flowing through a wire won't start a fire on its own. As the saying goes, you need a spark. The investigators think that the wire that was handling all this power frayed. A break in the insulation would expose the conductor underneath. From there, all it would take was a spark. In this case, you don't need two frayed wires for a spark. A spark could form between a frayed wire and any metallic surface nearby. This was in an airplane. Metallic surfaces aren't hard to come by. So, the frayed wire produced a spark with the airframe, and that spark set fire to the insulating material around the wires. Since the wires were outside of the control of the power limiters, the short circuit was not broken. The fire most likely caused a few batteries to explode, which caused the fire to grow even more. And before the pilots knew it, the fire was big enough to cause controllability issues as it burned through the aircraft itself. But they couldn't pinpoint an exact reason as to why the pilots were unable to control their plane. But the cascading series of failures that the pilots were experiencing points to a fire that was burning through important control systems. But why were the wires installed incorrectly? To find out why, they talked to the person who did the maintenance. He couldn't recall working on the accident airplane, as he had worked on it years ago, but he was able to walk them through the procedures for performing such a wiring procedure. Basically, if they had another plane that was already wired up, they'd copy from that plane, and if another plane was not available, they would refer to an FAA Form 337. After that, they ended up talking to the maintenance director of the facility that performed the modification. The director found out that on another plane where this modification was done, the technician who did the wiring was misdirected. You see, the wiring technician was in the electronics bay, and another technician was directing him. The directing technician just said, quote, "put it there," end quote. Put it where? The wiring technician connected the wires to the battery bus instead of the generator control panel. That mistake was then copied onto 14 other Learjets, and no one thought to refer to a line diagram. That's most likely how this mistake was made on the accident airplane. It was done on another plane, and someone copied that mistake onto the accident plane. No one caught the mistake. Days after the crash, the director of maintenance at the facility put out a bulletin for all the Learjets that they had modified and asked the operators to check for wire chafing and also asked them to reconnect the wires in the correct way. These days, Form 337 has a provision to attach detailed drawings, so if someone does make a similar mistake, it will be caught before a plane goes down. Even though the US Air Force and the Air National Guard did not cause this crash directly, the investigators felt that they were also kind of responsible for what happened. The US Air Force and the Air National Guard told the contractor to make the changes according to the FAA guidelines, but the oversight provided by the US Air Force and the Air National Guard was lacking. But in the end, this comes down to a technician overlooking technical drawings, thereby leaving wires unprotected. Those unprotected wires were subject to a lot of current because of a short circuit. Due to the lack of protection, the system could not shut itself down. From that point onwards, it was just a matter of time before a fire started. The investigators don't mince any words when it comes to the cause of this crash. Quote, coupled with the fact that 14 additional airplanes had been modified incorrectly, reflect on the competence of the individuals involved and a lack of adequate oversight by the operator's maintenance management personnel. End quote. Do you think we should implement a buddy system for maintenance? One person does stuff and the other just checks their work? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. A fire in the air rarely ends well. If you want to learn about a crew who narrowly escaped their burning plane, I'd highly recommend watching my video on UPS Flight 8. Link on your screen right now. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.